Hello everyone. So in previous video we talked about the classification, general characters and classification of protista, isn't it? So and also we have completed one division in that. So that is chrysophyta. So that includes diatoms. So you know the general characters or properties of the protist: unicellular eukaryotic organisms, they which consists of all cell organelles, and also they show the both the types of reproduction like asexual and sexual method of reproduction. So then about the classification, so where the kingdom Protista is mainly classified into three divisions like chrysophyta, euglenophyta and the photosynthetic protist, then slime molds, then protozoan protist, isn't it? So in that photosynthetic protist we have completed the first thing, that is about chrysophyta. So then the next division in that is euglenophyta. So I'm going to talk about the next divisions, that is about euglenophyta. See, some of the members of euglenophyta which are photosynthetic in nature and others are heterotrophic in nature. Okay, and the members of euglenophyta, they share the characters of both the plants as well as animals. Okay, because some members they are showing photosynthesis just like plants, whereas others they do not show photosynthesis and they are adapted for heterotrophic mode of nutrition. And also the members of euglenophytes, they lack cell wall, there is no cell wall in them, hence that is also a character that resemble with an animal. But the few members of them, they show photosynthesis, so that is a character of a plant, hence they share the characters between the plants as well as animals. Okay, so and this division that includes about 1000 species, it includes about 1000 species, about one third of them they show photosynthesis, about one third of the members of euglenophyta, so they are photosynthetic in nature. Okay, see, the cell are not surrounded by, there is no cell wall in these members, and the cells are surrounded by a flexible membrane, that is what is called as the pellicle. There is no cell wall here, okay, but the cells get surrounded by a flexible membrane, that is what is called as a pellicle. So this is asked for 1 marks question. Okay, what is pellicle? Pellicle is a membrane that around the cells or surrounding the cells of euglenophyta or euglenoids. Okay, so where that membrane, the flexible membrane, is what is called as the pellicle. Okay, so where this photosynthetic euglenophytes, they show chloroplast. Photosynthetic euglenophytes, they show chloroplast, and photosynthetic pigments like chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B and also carotenoids. So that is about the photosynthetic euglenoids. They possess chloroplast and chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B and other photosynthetic pigments. Okay. So whereas all membrane bounded cell organelles were present, as they are eukaryotic in nature, all membrane bounded cell organelles can be seen. Okay, so as they are eukaryotes, so then the cells possess an opening, a flask like opening at the anterior end. At the anterior end, that is what is called as the reservoir. The cells possess a flask-like opening at the anterior end, that is what is called as a reservoir. Okay, so this is a flask-like structures. The membrane, the members of the euglenophyta are euglenoids. So some of them are photosynthetic, some of them are heterotrophic in nature. So where the cell is not surrounded by the cell wall, so where they are surrounded by flexible membrane, that is what is called as a pellicle. And they show locomotion. See, this is structure of a cell of a euglena. Okay, so where the cells possessing a flagella, they possessing two unequal flagella. The cells possess two unequal flagella. One of them will be very long and another one will be short. And on one side of flagella, they show small hair-like structures on them. On one side of the flagella, they show very small hair-like structures, and the cell consists of a very large centrally situated nucleus, and irrespective, then they show the chloroplast and other cell organelles, where this outer membrane is what is called as a pellicle. This is what is known as pellicle, and this flask-like opening, this is what is known as a reservoir. So, this is what is called as a reservoir. Okay, the members, they are unicellular, where there is no cell wall, and the cells are surrounded by flexible membrane, that is what is called as pellicle. 1/3 of the members of euglenites are photosynthetic, and rest of them, they are heterotrophic mode of nutrition, they are adapted for. So then, the cells, they show at the anterior end, there will be a flask-like opening is present, that is what is called as a reservoir, and they are motile in nature. Euglenites are motile in nature because they possess flagella. There are two flagellas were there, one will be very long and another one will be very short. And on one side of the flagella, there are some small hair-like structures can be seen on one side of the flagella. Okay. So then there is a centrally situated large nucleus is there. So then these members, just like other proteins, they also show contractile vacuoles. Okay. So as they share the characters of animals, and also some of them they share the characters of plants. See here, what are the characters of animals that can be seen? So one is absence of cell wall, then presence of motile structures, they are motile in nature. Okay. So some of them they are heterotrophic in nature. Only few of them, about 1/3 of them, are photosynthetic in nature. So presence of chloroplast and photosynthetic pigment, that is a plant nature in some of the euglenoids. So that's why the phycologist means the person who is specialized in studying algae. Okay, phycologist, the person who studies algae or who is specialized in studying algae, or he well known about algae. So they are known as phycologists. The phycologist, they includes euglenoids under euglenophyta, means under the kingdom plantae, that is under the algae. Whereas the zoologist, so they include euglenoids, euglena or euglenophyta under euglenidae, so that is under the protozoa. So where you study about euglenophyta both in protozoa, so where they are placed euglenoids under the class mastigophora or flagellata. So in that you are going to study about euglenoids, or euglenoids were placed under the class of protozoa, mastigophora or flagellata. Whereas the plant scientist, like phycologist, because of the photosynthetic nature in some of the members of euglenophyta, they place them under the kingdom plantae, that is under algae. Okay. So because they share both the characters of animals as well as the plants. So some of the examples like euglena. So this is a major genus that is found in this class, that is euglena and astacea. Euglena, astacea, and paranema, etc. Euglena, astacea, and paranema, etc. Okay, so this is about euglenoids or euglenophyta. And another thing, they reproduce by means of longitudinal binary fission. They reproduce by means of longitudinal binary fission. Longitudinal binary fission. What is this longitudinal binary fission? See, you have seen the structure of the cell of euglena, isn't it? So this is an euglena cell. The longitudinal binary fission, that is nothing but the cell will divide into two equal halves by means of a vertical division. You can see here the cell that clearly divides into two equal halves by means of vertical division. You have seen or you have studied binary fission in bacteria, isn't it? So where the bacterial cell that equally divides and produces two daughter bacterial cells, isn't it? So this is what is called as transverse binary fission, means horizontal agantha binary fission. This is transverse binary fission, whereas this is a longitudinal binary fission. It takes place vertically. Okay. So thereby, by means of longitudinal binary fission, they reproduce. Their number of cells that will multiplies. Okay. And this is about the division euglenophyta. Okay. Then the next thing is pyrophyta. Under photosynthetic protist, pyrophyta. See, the members of pyrophyta, they are commonly known as dinoflagellates. So these are the common members of the division photosynthetic in that pyrophyta, that is dinoflagellates are the common members. Okay. and these are commonly known as fire algae. These are commonly known as fire algae because of their characteristic color, the golden brown color. Okay, so and almost all of these forms, they are marine forms. Almost all, they are marine forms. So dinoflagellates, almost all of them, they are marine forms. Means they are found in salt water. They are marine forms. Some of the forms of this dinoflagellates, the fire algae, they form red tide. These are the major members which causes red tide. Think you heard Red Sea, isn't it? The members of dinoflagellates, they are the major cause for red tide. They imparts a characteristic color. Okay. So these are the major members of the causing red tide. That is the dinoflagellates. So some examples like Noctiluca, Noctiluca and Unialax. Unialax. Okay. And Gymnodynema. Gymnodynema. So these are some of the examples for dinoflagellates. See, the members are the cells in the dinoflagellates where the cells get surrounded by the cell wall. Cell gets surrounded by cell wall. And here cell wall is made up of cellulose. Cell wall is made up of cellulose and it is deposited with silica. And it is deposited with silica just like the members of diatoms. Okay. But there are some differences were there here. So here also the cells were unicellular and dinoflagellates, they are exclusively marine in nature. They float on the surface of water. They are the major constituents of phytoplankton. They float on the surface of water. And they are the major cause for red tide. Okay. So where these members were commonly known as fire algae because of their characteristic color, golden brown color. So where the cells consist of cell wall and cell wall is composed of cellulose and there will be a deposition of silica on the cell wall. And cell wall is just like many plates. The cell wall is like many plates. Many plates united together forming the cell wall. Okay, our cell wall in the form of plates which are arranged together forming a composite structure, that is what is called as a cell wall. Okay. And the cell wall here is what is called as lorica or theca. The plate like cell wall here, it is named as lorica or theca. Okay. This is what is called as the cell wall, lorica or the theca. So then the cells possess two flagella. The cells are motile. The cells are motile and they possess two flagella and one will be smaller and another will be larger. Here among the two flagella, one is responsible for pushing and another one is responsible for pulling movement. One will drive the cell, one of the flagella that will drive the cell. So whereas another flagella that will push the cell. Okay, so both the kinds of movements can be seen. Like pushing and pulling movements, they were observed. So one of that will driving the cell, another one that will pushes the cell. Okay, so both the movements can be observed. That's why, because of the presence of two flagella and two kinds of movement, both the pushing as well as pulling movements of the flagella, dinoflagellates, they were also known as whirling whips. Because of the presence of two kinds of movements exhibited by flagella, dinoflagellates were also called as whirling whips. Means, girki odita iradum. Okay. So they were also called as whirling whips because of their movement, a characteristic movement in the water body. Because of the presence of two flagella, unequal flagella, one will pushes and another one will pulls the cells. Okay. So then some of the members are photosynthetic in nature. They show both the kinds of nutrition. Photosynthetic in nature means they are autotrophs and some are heterotrophs. Some are heterotrophs means they depends on other organisms for their food and among that there may be parasites also. Some of them are parasites. So some are symbiotic forms were also present. Some of them they are symbiotic forms are also present. Means mode of nutrition. They may be photosynthetic means autotrophs. Heterotrophs were also there. Among that some may be parasites or symbiotic and even saprobes were also there. Okay. So that is about the mode of nutrition. So where the cell that consists of the protoplasm encloses all the cell organelles. Means as they are eukaryotic in nature, so all cell, this is common for all eukaryotes. All cell organelles were found in the cell. some of the forms like gunyalax, they secrete some very strong toxins, okay, so which can cause the death of fishes which are found in the water body because of respiratory failure. The poisons which are secreted by some members of the pyrophyta or dinoflagellates, they secrete very strong toxins, means the poisonous substance, very strong toxins, and that will cause us respiratory failure in fishes. Because of that, many fishes, they will die. Okay, so hence they secrete a very strong toxins, and this toxins named as saxitoxin. Even one mark se keli rule sala. Okay, name the toxin secreted by dinoflagellates or pyrophyta members on the keli rule. The toxin named as saxitoxin. This accumulates in shellfishes. You heard about shellfishes? Okay, edible ones. They accumulate in shellfishes, and it do not harm them. Okay, it accumulates in shellfishes, but those humans will eat such shellfishes infected with saxitoxin. Andre, saxitoxin the infect agiranta shellfishes na human beings tindaga, where that causes a fatal effect or fatal damage in humans. Even it is effective for human beings also. That causes a fatal effect for human beings, and that is what is called as paralytic shellfish poisoning. If we eat those shellfishes which are infected with the saxitoxin, what is saxitoxin here? Saxitoxin is a poisonous substance that is secreted by some of the dinoflagellates. Okay, there are around 20 species of dinoflagellates. They secrete very toxic substances. So if that toxic accumulated in the shellfishes, it do not harm them usually, the shellfishes. If we eat them, such shellfishes which are infected with the saxitoxin, where in human beings it will be very fatal for human beings. So that causes paralytic shellfish poisoning. Okay, so that is a fatal effect of the saxitoxin and the other toxins which are secreted by them. So that causes the death of the fishes because of respiratory failure. Okay. And the members, they reproduce both asexually as well as sexually. Both the kinds of reproduction can be seen. Both the asexual method of reproduction as well as sexual method of reproduction that can be seen here. The asexual method of reproduction that takes place by means of fission. Fission, that is nothing but the division of the cell. In some of the forms, there will be formation of zoospores also. Means they are the kind of asexually reproducing cells. The zoospores, some forms, they reproduce by means of producing zoospores. And whereas the sexual reproduction, it may be isogamous, or in some members, it will be anisogamous. Isogamous means, if both male and female gametes are morphologically similar, one day male gamete to female gamete to morphology, iso means similar. Okay, both of them, if they are similar morphologically, such gametes are said to be isogametes, and mode of reproduction is said to be isogamous. If male and female gametes are morphologically dissimilar, like female gamete is larger in size, male gamete is smaller in size, okay, and such a mode of reproduction is said to be anisogamous reproduction. Okay, so they reproduce either by means of isogamous method or by means of, that is sexual reproduction I am talking about. So, or anisogamous reproduction, or some members also show conjugation. Okay, means that is, you heard in bacteria, so where the two bacteria united by means of a conjugation tube or a conjugation bridge, isn't it? Similarly, in these members also, two cells which are united together by means of a conjugation tube, by which the exchange of materials that will take place. So they also reproduce by means of conjugation. So this is a mode of reproduction in dinoflagellates. And they have a characteristic pigment that is what is called as fucoxanthin. A brownish pigment called as fucoxanthin. So this is a characteristic pigment that imparts a color for them. That is fucoxanthin. Okay, so then just glance about the characters of dinoflagellates. So most of them, they are marine in nature. Okay, so they are also unicellular, just like other protists. So they show two flagella. So one will be for pushing movement, another one will pulse the cells. Hence, they are also popularly known as whirling whips, means they are rotating inside the water body, whirling whips. So then they have a cell wall, that is what is called as theca or lorica. So where the cell wall is just like plates, which are arranged like a, the cell wall arranged like a plates, and it is made up of cellulose, and there will be a deposition of silica also in them. Some members of the dinoflagellates, they possess a very strong toxic substances, okay, so which may cause a respiratory failure in fishes and other aquatic organisms, that leads to the death of them. Similarly, the toxin named as saxitoxin, so that accumulates in the shellfishes. So if human beings, if they eat such shellfishes infected with that, so that will cause us PSP. PSP stands for paralytic shellfish poisoning. Okay. So then they reproduce by means of asexual as well as sexual method. Asexual method of reproduction takes place by means of fission or by means of zoospores. So sexual method of reproduction by means of isogamous or anisogamous or by means of conjugation. And there is a presence of a characteristic pigment called as fucoxanthin. And also some members of these dinoflagellates like Noctiluca, they possess bioluminescence. They possess bioluminescence, means emission of light by the living organisms. Means they have the property of phosphorescence. Okay, so where they emit the light, that is the organism like Noctiluca, and that process is what is called as bio. Bio means life, luminescence means emission of the light. So that is what is called as bioluminescence. So that can be seen in the members of Dinoflagellata. Okay, so that is under Pyrophyta. Okay, and this completes about the photosynthetic protist. So that is Chrysophyta, Euglenophyta and Pyrophyta. That is in the photosynthetic protist. Then about the second divisions in photosynthetic protist is slime molds. The second division in photosynthetic protist is slime molds. It is slime molds. Okay. See here, the slime molds, they were named as such slime molds because of their slimy nature. Ontara antantagi gelatinous natural iranta nature irutte. Because of their slimy nature, these members are known as slime molds. Because of the slimy means antantagi jaranta nature iradrinda, transparent gelatinous nature iradrinda, idanna slime molds anta karitare. Okay. See, they share the characters of the animals, plants as well as fungi. Means the mixture of characters they exhibit. They exhibit the characters of animals, they show the characters of plants, and they exhibit the characters of fungi. So by being heterotrophic and saprophytic mode of nutrition and by producing the spores, spores produce maadi heterotrophic mode of nutrition iddu, amale saprophytic mode of nutrition show maadadrinda, so they considered as fungi because of the formation of spores. And they always present in dark and shady places. Because of that, they share the character of fungi. That is the character of fungi in them. Presence of cell wall, okay, in the spores, not in the adult members, that is in the spores. Spores only cell wall iradrinda. As that cell wall is made up of cellulose, so that is a characteristic feature of a plant. Then, do not having the cell wall in adult members, means adult slime molds only cell wall illde iradrinda. And they do not possess the chlorophyll or chloroplast. So because of they show heterotrophic mode of nutrition just like animals, hence they are, that is the character of animals. Means they show the mixture of characters like plants, animals as well as fungi. So they cannot be categorized in any of the group. So the mycologist means the person who is specialized in fungi. Mycologist, they placed under the kingdom Mycota, that is in Myxomycetes. Earlier they were placed under the kingdom fungi, kingdom Mycota, under the class Myxomycetes. Later on, the recent biologists, they placed slime molds under the protista. Okay, so you know the protista is classified or grouped into photosynthetic protists, slime molds and protozoan protists, isn't it? Among that, this is the second category, slime molds. Okay, see, these slime molds, they usually grow in moist, moist, shady environment. they usually grow in moist, shady environment. Okay, that is usually on a dead and decaying matter. Dead and decaying matter. Because majority of them, they are saprophytic in nature. Okay, few are parasites also, but majority of them, they are the saprophytic. That is on dead and decaying matter. So where usually on wooden logs, wood or logs, or any on any moist surfaces like fallen leaves in the forest, or on any kind of moist surface that preferably shady environment. Usually they avoid to expose to sunlight. Okay, so they always wants to present in shady environment, a moist shady environment. So then the adult members, the adult ones in them do not show cell wall, or there is no cell wall in adult members. Adult forms only cell wall irala. Only the spores produced by them, they will show the cell wall. But the adult forms, they lack the cell wall. So where they consist of a multinucleate protoplasm. They consist of multinucleate protoplasm without cell wall. They consist of a multinucleate protoplasm without cell wall, and that is what is called as plasmodium. Nature na naavu plasmodium anta kaithu. What is plasmodium here? Plasmodium andre ond organism ide that is under the protozoa, but here plasmodium means a multinucleate protoplasm without, surrounded by cell wall. Andre, so just like this, many number of nuclei which are dispersed in the protoplasm, where there is no exact cell wall around them. Adu sutta irala, exact cell wall irala. Can see here many number of nuclei which are dispersed in the protoplasm without, surrounded by cell wall. Such a condition is what is called as plasmodium. Adana na plasmodium condition anta karikiri. Okay, and they are found on the surface of, they are found on the surface of leaves or wooden logs, okay, like that, or even on moist rocks also. So they show gliding movement in them, or amoeboid movement in them. They show amoeboid movement. So that is because of the lack of cell wall. Okay, they show amoeboid movement by means of possessing structures like pseudopodia. I think you heard pseudopodia in amoeba, isn't it? So by possessing structures like pseudopodia, so they show amoeboid or gliding movement on the surface of the substratum. Substratum means elli grow agirutta aa surface mele slide aagta hogutte athwa amoeboid movement. So just like how amoeba moves, like that, so they also shows amoeboid or gliding movement or sliding movement. Okay, so that is by means of pseudopodia. So then the members, I said all of them, most of them, they are saprophs in nature. Saprophs means they derive the nutrition from dead and decaying matter. Few of them, they are parasites on animals or plants. Okay, so by that they get their nutrition. So they reproduce by means of producing spores. They reproduce by producing spores. Okay, see, the spores are produced from the adult and avagalide lack the cell wall, multinucleate protoplasm. So like this, a multinucleate protoplasm without being surrounded by the cell wall, this is an adult organism. Okay, they produce spores from the adult in by means of the structures what is called as sporangia. They bear the structures called as sporangia, which is produced from the surface of adult body, like this. See, these are nothing but the sporangia, and they encloses the spores in them. They encloses the spore in them. What is a spore here? A spore is a specialized reproductive structure, a reproductive unit. Okay. Once the spore germinate, that is able to produce an organism. Okay. So the spore which are born in or which are produced in sporangia. See, just like a seed, how a fruit that encloses a seed, you know, similar to that, the spores, the sporangia that encloses the spores. So where many number of spores which are produced inside the sporangia, and they are produced from the adult body, that is from the plasmodium, and they were found inside the sporangia. Okay, so this is how they reproduce. See, once these spores, they germinate, means once they fallen on the suitable substratum, ಸೊ ಒನ್ಸ್ ದೇ ಕಮ್ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸ್ಪೊರಾಂಜಿಯಾ ದೇ ಜರ್ಮಿನೇಟ್ ಸ್ಪೊರಾಂಜಿಯಾ ಇಂದ ಆಚೆ ಬಂದ ಮೇಲೆ ಸ್ಪೋರ್ಸ್ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಜರ್ಮಿನೇಟ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಐದರ್ ದೇ ಜರ್ಮಿನೇಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸರ್ಸ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಮಿಕ್ಸಮ್ ಇದೆ Either they germinate and produces the structures like mixed amoeba, which it means which is similar to the amoeba. So you remember one thing I already said: the spores are surrounded by cell wall, which is made up of cellulose. The spores are surrounded by means of cell wall, that is made up of cellulose. Cellulose in the formation agiranta, cell wall in the spores surround agiranta. Okay. So where once the spore germinate, and the spore is suitable substrate amele fall agi. Once it germinates, you know. Where that produces the structures like mixed amoebae means which are similar to smaller amoeba, which are similar to amoeba in structure. Okay. So whereas the other spores, some of them, they may produce swarm cells. Some produce swarm cells. Swarm cells are flagellated in nature, so they possess flagella. They possess two flagella. Swarm cells. These are swarm cells. And these are mixed amoebae. These are swarm cells, and these are mixed amoebae. Okay. So that is they are produced by the germination of spore. Spore germination agi produce agatha do either the swarm cells or the mixed amoebae. Okay. See, both of them they participate in sexual reproduction. They acts as gametes. They acts as gametes. Okay. So where the two mixed amoebae they fuse together. Forming a diploid structure, that is what is called as a zygote. Here, the mixed amoeba fuse agi, one zygote formation agatha. Similarly, the two swarm cells they fuse together, forming the structure, the diploid structure, that is what is called as a zygote. And that zygote that develops into the adult. That zygote that develops into the adult by means of meiosis. So, where the organisms are haploid in nature, so that undergoes, divides, and that produces the adult organism, means adult slime molds. Okay, so what are slime molds here? They were mainly named as slime molds because of their slimy nature. They usually grows in dark place, dark, moist environment. So where the dead and decaying matter or organic matter is rich in that area, okay, usually in forest areas. And also, they show gliding movement or sliding movement by means of pseudopodia. The adult forms which lack the cell wall, whereas the cell wall is found in the spores, where that is made up of cellulose, okay, or glucosamide. So where they are saprophytic in nature. Most of them they are saprophytic in nature. Few are parasites also. Parasites on plants as well as on animals. Okay. So then, the next thing they reproduce sexually as well as asexually. So that is by producing the spores. Spores which develops on within the sporangia. Okay. Avale diagram bardi dena no. Within that the spores will develop and those spores they germinate. The spores are surrounded by cell wall. And spores that germinate into either mixed amoebae produce mixed amoebae or swarm cells. What is the difference between them? Mixed amoebae do not have flagella. They show pseudopodia. By that they can move. Whereas swarm cells, they possess the flagella. So the swarm cells, either two swarm cells or two mixed amoebae, they fuse together forming the zygote that develops into adult organism. Okay. And there are about 500 species were there in slime molds. Among that, 20 species which are reported from India. Among that, 20 species reported from India. And they have a pigment in their protoplasm that is like anthracene. They have pigments in their protoplasm that is anthracene. So that gives different color for the slime molds. So where different colors like the yellow color or orange color or brown color, okay, different in they can be present in various colors. That is because of the presence of the pigments in the protoplasm that is called as what is called as anthracene. Okay, and also the body of the slime mold. So where the protoplasm near the peripheral region, which is usually transparent. Andre ee region alli iranta protoplasm. The protoplasm near the peripheral region, sides alli iranta protoplasm. Surrounding the protoplasm near the peripheral region, which is usually transparent. Transparent means which is colorless. And the protoplasm which is present in the center, that is surrounding the nucleus. Nucleus surrounding alli iranta. The central iranta protoplasm that is colored in nature. That is because of the presence of anthracene. Okay, so where it exhibits various colors. Okay, so in this video, you studied about the other members of the photosynthetic protist like Euglenophyta and Pyrophyta, isn't it? So then the next division in the kingdom protista, that is about the slime moths. So we have left with only one, that is protozoa. After completing protozoa, in next video I also start with the another kingdom, that is what is called as mycota, or I discuss about fungi. Okay.